The Oval, 1938. Len Hutton batted for more than 13 and a quarter hours to make a record test match score of 364.
Bradman is first to congratulate Hutton. What a day for the 22-year-old Yorkshireman who goes on to make 364 before being sent back.
Today, I think, has been one of the happiest days of my cricketing career. I managed to beat Don's great record, and I must say I felt very pleased when I had achieved it.
It was a wonderful innings from a point of view of technique, because he always had a particularly good technique. Concentration and, above all, determination.
Yorkshireman through and through, and you know, you talk to Fred Truman about Sir Len Hutton, and he'll say, you know, great, great man. A typical Yorkshireman, very dour, forthright, very, very, I suppose, whether it was a compliment to Sir Len or not, I don't know, but that's where Sir Geoffrey, the Geoffrey Boycott, sort of said, you know, it was something that, you know, he sort of looked upon as if you like, a model, that he felt, you know, he wanted to be a pillar of strength, as Sir Len was.
Technically, Hutton was as close to perfect as any batsman ever to play the game.
Marvellous, marvellous technique. I've never seen a batsman that was anywhere near Len Hutton for technique.
I never saw anyone with a better technique than Len Hutton, better batting technique.
He was a great technician. Beautiful stance, always beautifully turned out as a cricketer, always looked the part, just waited on the loose ball. And a lot of people forget back in those days too, though, a lot of these opening batsmen and batsmen played on uncovered wickets. And Len Hutton had to combat that. He also had great opposition in Ray Lindwell and Keith Miller, Bill Johnston to contend with. Did it well. South Africa had a terrific bowling lineup back in those days. And he really was the epitome, I think, of an excellent opening batsman.
He had the most relaxed stance. And as the bowler ran in, he basically didn't move. But just as you're about to deliver, the back foot would start, you could see it sort of starting to get the edgy, and then it would just move. As you delivered it, the right foot would go back and across. You know, and that sort of took him back into a position where he gave himself that extra half a yard, a yard, to watch the ball. Len just had so much time to play shots. He was just the most complete, technically correct player I've ever seen.
He was played very straight, and his footwork was very precise. Like all English players, he learnt to play on a variety of wickets.
People tend to label Len as a conservative batsman, but he was an attractive stroke player, and everything was done with the perfect technique.
Long before he made his first class debut, at age 17, Len Hutton had been groomed for greatness.
Through the 30s, Yorkshire were the greatest side in English county cricket, and they won a number of county titles. Hutton came from Pudsey, which is where Herbert Sutcliffe had come from, and he became something of a protege of Sutcliffe. When Sutcliffe first saw him in the nets, he recognised his great talent. And one of the things that they taught batsmen at Yorkshire, especially opening batsmen, was that you don't give your wicket away. And I think that was something that came through in Hutton's play right through his career.
Having played against Yorkshire, you know, if you can imagine, they've got Macintoshes on, it's sleet that's falling, they're still playing, and then here are the players playing. You've got these spectators that are there, and they're there, and they've got their flasks of whatever it might be. And you can imagine that sort of atmosphere, that sort of environment, is what makes Yorkshire players so hard. You took on a Yorkshireman, you took on, you know, you were taking on the toughest people you could ever meet.
Cricket in Yorkshire really is a religion. There's no other word to describe it. Going down through the years, county cricket is really the holy grail for Yorkshire members. And if you look at the quality of players they produced down the years, it's no surprise to know that they've been the most successful side at county level for over 100 years. And the saying always is, if it's a strong Yorkshire, it's a strong England.
He played his cricket and made England great. I mean, he was the captain when England in the 1950s were unequivocally the best team in the world, and they haven't been able to say that very often. And that was really his Yorkshire grit shone through that team and made them the earthy and dominant side that they turned out to be.
Hutton's test debut was unremarkable. He scored 0-1, but he rectified matters in his second test at Old Trafford.
He was playing for England when he was 20. I mean, that in itself is unusual. And there was this, after the fouling in his first test, there was the thought, was he just a bit of a boy wonder, if you like? But then he set that record straight by scoring 100.
A year later, at the Oval against Don Bradman's Australian side, Hutton broke the test match record, scoring a glorious 364.
Every day we went out there, Hutton was batting. That's what it seemed like. He was very watchful, didn't play any risky shots, and he played steadily up and down the line, handled O'Reilly very well. He obviously must have read his Bosie. And he just kept going day after day. He was there all the first day, all the second day, and part of the third day.
Dad had taken the battery out of the truck and brought it down, and we had an aerial that ran from the house to a big gum tree about 50 yards away. And we had the old static radio that went clonk and crash, crash. And then, of course, many years later, I found out that Alan McGilvray was tapping with a pencil on the thing, and it was all from cables. But I can remember that I listened to every ball of every bowled in that whole series in 1938. And I was aware of Len getting the 364.
Here's a historic stroke that does it.
Len Hutton was still a relatively young man when he made that 364, and it was a phenomenal achievement of concentration which spanned 3 days. Nobody thought that he was capable of playing that sort of innings at that time in his career, but he eclipsed not only Don Bradman, whose previous best score, of course, was 334, but also Walter Hammond, 336. Hammond himself had beaten Bradman's record.
Hutton's 364, the thing about it that separates it is his concentration. He broke Wally Hammond's record, but Hammond had scored his runs in about 5 hours. Bradman had scored 300 in a day. But what Hutton did, he batted for over 13 hours, and throughout his concentration was extraordinary. And if there's one instance that captures that, it was that when he was 333, one short of Bradman's then Ashes record, O'Reilly decided to bowl him a couple of no balls. And Hammond just played them straight back down the wicket. It was just his concentration was such that nothing could break his concentration. But Hutton himself admits that a couple of times he felt like throwing it away. And during that time, we look up at the dressing room, and Wally Hammond, his captain, who'd fielded through all of Bradman's big scores for the last decade, he was there saying, "No, keep going," which I guess says something about Hammond's psyche as well as Hutton.
Well, I think every schoolboy looks at the 364, even today, and wonders at it and looks at how long it took, 13 hours, 17 minutes. He was 22 years of age at his peak. And in fact, a year later in 39, he was said to be batting as well as any Englishman or possibly any batsman could ever have batted.
In his first 13 tests, Hutton had made 1,345 runs at an average of 67.25. In 1939 alone, he made 2,883 first-class runs, including 12 centuries, all built on a blend of technique and toughness. Hutton was at the pinnacle of his career, but he would not play another test match for 7 years.
And then came the war, and like so many, he lost those 6 years, and it's a wonder that he was effective as he was after the war, but he was born to bat.
Len Hutton missed 6 years of his career as a result of the war. Wally Hammond, a lot of his career disappeared because of the war as well. Hutton injured himself during the war in a gymnasium accident, and as a result of that, one of his arms was shortened. It restricted his cricket after the war. Those players, they'll remain great, no question about it, particularly Hammond and Hutton, who came back after the war and played again. But there's no way of telling what they could have achieved if they had an extra 6 years in their career.
Having been forced by his injury to virtually eliminate the hook and pull shot, Hutton was forced to rework his technique to counter a barrage of short-pitched bowling from Australian pace duo Keith Miller and Ray Lindwall.
It was a horrible injury. It was a commando training injury during the war. He basically needed three bone grafts to replace his left elbow. He basically fell off the climbing frame in the gym, and it would have ruined most careers, most lives. But he rebuilt his game and rebuilt the dominance of his left arm, which was the incredible thing, because he'd always been a player who believed in the top hand being the dominant hand, and all of a sudden it was withered. It was 3 inches shorter than it had started out, but he managed to persuade it to be strong again, and really reinvented his game. He always said in hindsight that he wished people had seen him as a cricketer before that injury, because he was much freer, much more flashy player in his youth.
Hutton during the war was injured, and his left arm was shorter than his right. But he overcame that, and really, I don't think it didn't seem to have any effect on his game.
He was a very complete player. Like, it wasn't that he couldn't play the shots. It's just that he decided that the percentages had to be exactly his way before he would attempt it. And that percentage play was the essential part of his whole technique.
The Headingley ground was packed for the test.
Back home in a series against South Africa, Hutton scored a century in his first test at Leeds. Then at the Oval a year later, in Don Bradman's last test, he top scored for England in both innings.
In Bradman's last test, England made 52 in the first innings, and Hutton made more than half of them, and he also made a big score in the second innings. Another thing that's overshadowed by the fact that Bradman made a duck, another player who to some extent lived in Bradman's shadow.
With Bradman retired, he was now the world's premier batsman.
I think by the early 50s, he was the master batsman of that time, really. Classical, correct, reliable, good to watch.
Len, if you had to take him day in, day out on all types of wickets, he was just the supreme artist.
Technically, I suppose England's best ever batsman post Second World War, although he played a little bit before the war, obviously, but certainly in the 50s, he was regarded as head and shoulders above anybody.
In 1950, Hutton carried his bat against the great West Indian spinners Ramadan and Valentine, scoring 202 not out.
1950 tour that the West Indies made to England, that was their first Test Series victory in England, and Ramadan and Valentine really were the men who weaved a magic spell over the English batsmen throughout that summer. So for Len Hutton to come along and make a double century as he did, that really was an outstanding achievement. Those two bowlers really held sway over England until 1957, you would say. So for Len Hutton to play that innings really was an outstanding achievement.
In Australia in 1950-51, Hutton was clearly the best batsman on either side. His best innings, though, didn't yield a century.
I think that was the series in which Hutton established himself as the best player in the world. And he did that in extraordinary circumstances. The first test in Brisbane, Australia batted on the first day and were all out just before stumps for 228. And it then rained. And when England had to come into bat, the wicket was appalling. And they declared their first innings at 7 for 68. And Australia then went in, and the wicket was just lethal. And I think Hutton in the first innings had batted at number 8, and I think was left 8 not out. But after Australia declared their second innings at 7 for 32, England then was set 190 odd to win, but they then lost 6 wickets before stumps. Hutton, being held back to the next day, then played a very famous innings of 62. And where everyone else for 2 days had been totally at sea on the wicket, Hutton was fine. And he, for the last wicket, there was a period where Australia looked like losing a game. They would have been inconceivable that they would have lost, but for Hutton's extraordinary effort.
After becoming the first Test player to carry his bat twice when scoring 156 in Adelaide, Hutton led England to victory in Melbourne, scoring 60 not out in the second innings. This was England's first win in an Ashes match since 1938.
In the 50-51 series, Australia, they'd won 3-0 in 46-7, then 4-0 in England with the Invincibles in 48. And then they won the first four tests in 50-51. But England came out in the fifth test, and Hutton guided them to victory in the last day, scored 60 not out. It was just another example in that series of what a good player he was.
Len Hutton was captain of England for Australia's tour of 1953. He was the first professional cricketer to be given the job.
He was the first professional captain, and that was a big, big deal in an era when there was still that professional amateur divide. It was closing all the time. It would finally be abolished in the 1960s, so only 10 years after he had taken over. But it was a big, big step for English cricket to appoint a Yorkshireman, a man who was paid to do what he did. It was deemed a bit grubby in the early days of English cricket.
Lord Hawke, the old Yorkshireman who had captained England and was one of the mainstays of English cricket, had said a professional would never captain England at cricket. And certainly a cricketer like Jack Hobbs accepted the fact that, you know, the amateurs ran the game. So that when Hutton was made captain, I mean, it was such a huge thing for certainly the hierarchy of English cricket. And I imagine that he would have been in an awkward situation, knowing full well that there were people in the long room at Lords and in the MCC committee who were just waiting for him to fail. And that may have been part of the reason why he has a reputation as being a very conservative captain, that he couldn't afford to fail.
I think what Len did was decide to slow the game up and not take any risks. And I can understand that a bit, because he was the first professional captain of England. And I think a few people at Lord's were just waiting for him to make a decision that could have been a disaster. But I think he was rather reluctant to do so.
Hutton scored a century at Lord's, and after four drawn matches, England won the series and the Ashes in the last test at the Oval.
His captaincy records, particularly against Australia, he was the man who brought the Ashes home in 1953. 19 years England had waited, basically ever since Bradman had become a force in the world game. They hadn't had a sniff of them. Bradman was gone, England had a chance, and they took it, and they won 1-0 to euphoric scenes in the Queen's coronation year. It was a wonderful moment for England.
I think he was a very proud Yorkshireman. You know, he was a very proud Englishman on the day, because, like, let's face it, England hadn't won for a long time. And, you know, it had been a battle right through the series. It had gone this way and that. I thought Lindsay Hassett on the day was absolutely fantastic, the way he, the speeches he made and the remarks and the whole thing. And he acknowledged it. And let's face it, I think there was no doubt that in that fifth test we were outplayed.
On the Australian tour of 54-55, the Ashes were retained, but the cricket was less than riveting. Hutton employed a battery of fast bowlers and slow over rates to wear his opponents down.
He was a very pragmatic captain and a very successful captain, but he did decide, for example, in Australia in 54-55, that he would slow the game down. He recognised that his greatest strength was his fast bowlers, and he worked on the principle that if his fast bowlers bowled fewer overs in a day, one, they wouldn't be as tired, and two, the opposition wouldn't be facing as many deliveries. So both worked to his advantage. I think slowing the game down in that way, because the method worked and they won the series, people started to copy him, the game slowed down, so that by the end of that decade, cricket was in the doldrums. It was very, very dull. And Hutton, I guess, has to take some of the blame for that. But I think a lot of the criticism came from Australia, who'd lost.
He played to win. Like, as I say, in the 55 series, when he slowed the over rate up, he basically removed that. One mightn't have called that really in the spirit of playing cricket, but then on the other hand, the tactics were perfect. He had the people that enabled him to do that particular style of play. And you can't blame it. If that's your strength, we'll play to it.
In some ways, Hutton was ahead of his time. He certainly had a win-at-all-costs attitude. And in that, perhaps he learnt some of that from Hammond, who learnt some of that from Bradman. And Hutton, in the years immediately after the war, wore a lot of bounces from Linwell and Miller. And I think it hardened his attitude to the game. And the combination of all those things, I think it turned him into a tough, relentless sort of captain and a strategist. And I think, I think it's fair to say that he was ahead of his game.
Whilst Hutton's methods could be questioned, his results could not. He never lost a test series as captain.
No question about Len Hutton's qualities, both as a captain and an opening batsman. He really led from the front, led by example, very strong man, very strong-willed man, and really England, any side in fact, could do with someone of his abilities at any era.
Len Hutton retired in 1956 and was knighted soon after for his services to cricket, the second Englishman after Jack Hobbs to be so honoured. Sir Len Hutton died in 1990, having served his country and the game he loved with distinction. Sir Len Hutton played 79 test matches. He made 6,971 runs at an average of 56.67 with 19 centuries. He hit just two sixes in test matches. He captained England 23 times, regained and retained the Ashes, and never lost a series.
If in that time you're talking about pillars of strength, Sir Len was the one. I mean, he was the one that, if you like, sides wanted to get out. He was a man that came in first and was a guy that you needed to get rid of, otherwise he would love to bat all day.
Well, I saw him in Sydney on two tours. He quickly became a hero because I just thought he batted so artistically. And of course there was the underlying story that he was a frail man who'd been damaged during the war with a broken left arm, and he was taking a lot of very fast, hostile bowling. The interesting thing about Len, as I got to know him, was the personality of the man. He was by nature very reticent, reluctant to talk in almost all situations, but he was forced to talk at press conferences. And when he did talk, of course, he was not quite the Yorkshireman that he started out. He moved to the south of England, got the knighthood, which, like a lot of humble men, he found fairly weighty. The eyes of the world were upon him as a professional cricketer, really worth a knighthood. But I love the man, and for me, he was the greatest batsman that England had ever produced. I didn't see some of the others, but I saw him, and I've got memories still.
He was instrumental in returning England to pre-eminence in world cricket. But despite the fame and the honours, the stress, the controversy and the glory, he remained very much his own man. He left cricket as the same unassuming man he'd been when his career began. His dour defensive attitude provoked criticism, but Sir Len Hutton cannot be denied his place amongst ESPN's Legends of Cricket.